far we've had a pretty full morning, from our sunrise service to our breakfast. And I guess we're going to have a, have you already done the egg hunt here in the sanctuary?
Yes.
Okay, very good. So we've had a small egg hunt, resurrection egg hunt, and due to our spending too much time enjoying our breakfast, I guess, why we'll have our full-fledged resurrection egg hunt after worship service. Announcements for any of you who may be interested, our annual report is available for anyone upon request. We do a Bible study almost every Sunday from 1:30 to 2:30. Today there will be none. However, next Sunday we will continue that Bible study. And we do it online also. My son helps to lead the Bible study from where he's living in West Virginia. And we have several other people who log online to take part. And the one thing that's perhaps somewhat different from our Bible study than most of them is that we look at the Bible from what the people who are in attendance need to hear from the Word of God, things that might be on their mind, questions they might have, and look throughout the Scriptures for what the Bible has to say about that particular need or issue. Also, we're going to be going through a vision casting process in May and June. We ask your prayers for that. Those who attend regularly or who would like to be attending more often, we'd like to know a commitment from each person for 5 minutes a day to just pray for that process. It's really been probably 5 years since this church has really looked at any kind of a vision of where we go and what we need to be doing. And we feel it's time to actually get a direction that we can really focus our time and energy on. You'll find in your bulletin, I believe, a Easter offering envelope. We asked, what's one of two offerings we take up during the year. The other is Christmas, helps to balance the budget, helps to have people have that sense of, at Easter time, to give a little more to be able to help things go. The next two Sundays, Bill Ice will be leading worship. I've shared with him a series of two messages that he will share with you. Because I'm going to be out of town. When I'm back, I will do the third part. It's a three-part series. I'll do the third part. On the 29th of April, Reverend David Allen will be guest speaker. He's a gentleman who went through a auto accident, had brain damage, and yet has recovered enough to actually be a witness for the Lord and what God has done in his life. And we'll have a church council meeting after worship service that day. Any announcements that I've missed? I may have missed some. Okay. Absolutely. Absolutely. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the lands. Serve the land Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. He's made us. We are his. We are the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. And indeed, as we consider the very specialness of today, his faithfulness has come down from really the beginning of the Scriptures to this very day. His faithfulness to his word, his faithfulness to the salvation that he has promised us. And today is a culmination, obviously, of Jesus' time here on the earth. And as we say, the resurrection really is the proof that Jesus is who he said he was. And just as he's already done what he said he would do in the past, that we can also have faith he will do the same in the future. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the opportunity to be in your house together this morning. We thank you for the grace and the love and the patience that you have with us. We thank you for the many blessings that you've given us. We thank you for your word that has come down from centuries ago that continues to teach us and inspire us and help us to know you better. We thank you, Lord, the most for the gift of your Son, Jesus, that by his life and death and resurrection, we are set free from the bondage of sin, free to serve you, free to walk with you, free to have a life that is much, much better than anything the world can offer on its own. And as we consider this gift that you've given us, as we consider the joy of Resurrection Sunday, following the somberness and the sadness and the pain and suffering from Thursday evening until this morning, as we consider all that and consider the greatness of your Son, Jesus, we would pray together the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Our reading for this morning. Do you have a book there? Oh, here it goes. You want it? In the gray hymnal, number 364, The Lord is Risen. This comes from Luke 25:24-5-6, 1 Corinthians, and Second Book of John. Okay, I'll read the light, you folks read the dark, okay? Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. The Lord has risen.
He has risen indeed.
The Lord has risen.
He has risen indeed.
The Lord has risen.
He has risen indeed.
Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? Death has been swallowed up in victory. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die.
Thanks be to God. He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
The Lord has risen. He has risen indeed. Alleluia. Absolutely. Our music is not in the hymnal. If you know the song, you're more than welcome to sing along with it. It's O Glorious Day. Our recording, I believe, is by the Gaithers.
This is Casting
Crowns. Casting Crowns. Okay. Very good.
Jesus means the stars, the world of virgin, Jesus my man, example his spirit. Word he seems that, the light shine of my heart, glory living in love.
Me, the high, he saved me, Jesus has me. Now she's a rose friend. Now he needed to ask me. He embraced me. Started to hear the energy. Glorious day. Glorious day. Lives Turn it up just a smidge, Ron. Just a smidge. Good.
Get that set up, man.
Do we still need a new board for that?
Yeah, we're gonna need a whole new everything.
We'll figure it out. We'll figure out how to get it. And he saved me. He leads me. A glorious day. Amen. For those of you who missed seeing the words on a screen, we do have, Ryan's got a Christian karaoke system set up. And hopefully within a few weeks, we're going to have it set up for our screen here that we do have. It's just not out. You folks who are here for the sunrise service got to see the screen. And we do want to have that so that when we have songs that's not in our hymn book, we can still sing along and enjoy taking part in it. Let us then continue our worship by bringing of our tithes and offerings. You have the doxology, Ryan? Get it? We'll take it all. Okay, let us sing the doxology together, Ryan. praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen. Lord God, indeed we do thank you and praise you for all that you've done for us. As we consider all that you've given to us, we in turn bring these gifts to give something back to you. It's one way that we can take part in sharing the good news and building your kingdom. For what we do to your glory. So we would ask you bless both the giver and the gift. So we ask in Jesus' name, amen. We now come to that part of our service which in some ways is one of the most important parts. It is a part in which we join with others as part of the body of Christ to speak to God through prayer. Scriptures say that we need to, at times, just be by ourselves to pray. Scriptures also say there are times when we gather together, we need to be united in prayer. And prayer actually helps us to get in sync with God. He already knows what we need. He already knows the issues that are on our minds. But as we talk to Him about it, we grow closer to Him and in sync with what He would have us do. We're also saying we're trusting Him to work it out. And so it is a time then that can be very special in terms of building our relationship with God. And in offering up in prayer, we're also offering up things to God's timetable. Oftentimes, we want things, we want them too quickly, or we want them in a way that's not in keeping with God's plan. Yet if we turn it over to Him, we find that His timing and the way it works out is better than what we would have imagined, sometimes quite different. So prayer is that process of joining together in order to talk to God. Anything anybody wants to offer up this morning to hold up, either praise for things God's done in your life or a petition for God's special attention. Bill?
Like prayer for Mary Palmer, though, that's our daughter's mother-in-law. I don't know exactly how we should pray for her, but it would be from God's intervention. They've already called hospice.
Heavy?
I'm just thankful that so many people showed up today.
So many come to share this special Sunday with us.
Prayer for our son and his and three friends of his family. He had a funeral that he went to on Monday for Mr. Marburger. And he found out on Wednesday that Mr. Hallett passed away, and on Thursday, Doug Denzig's father-in-law passed away. So this week he has had a funeral and two deaths, very, very, very close friends.
Okay, this is Doug's friends?
Doug's and Jim's friends, both of us.
Okay, very good. Anything else? Go ahead.
I have to take the offerings and prayers, even though I was feeling absolutely horrendous this morning. But I was nervous and I took to work, and God is here. So.
Good.
Ryan?
Shane's. Shane's parents. Okay, good.
Go ahead.
Shane's parents. Shane's mom's making progress, and his dad's getting better.
Josh?
Betty Jo just said, my protection for her granddaughter for her future. Because her mom isn't really the best mom. And she has a really bad temper, so.
Hey, what's her granddaughter's name?
Gemma.
Gemma?
J-E-M-M-A.
Okay, very good. Josh?
I'm simply grateful that so many people that are not only our friends, but people that I've served in could attend this church today.
Mm-hmm. Very good. I think, as always, we want to remember travel mercies, whether we just travel around the block or, like some people know, go back and forth to Florida. You go back and forth 3 times a week, don't you?
Not quite.
And my wife and I are be going down to Florida to visit our daughter. So also travel mercies for us. I think we want to both thank God for miracles past as well as miracles present and future.
I just want to thank God for this church.
Okay.
I love this church.
I think God does too. And we've got factual evidence if you ever want to hear the history where we believe that. Just a second. Go ahead.
I have 2 things. I have a guy who worked at which is found out he has cancer.
First name?
His name's Bob.
Bob?
Yeah. They have hospice in his house and he's going for chemotherapy right now.
Okay.
And then just thanks for my family for everything he's given to me and my family.
Being a person of faith, everybody here is technically your family. And I know what you say. The ones that we grow up with and nurture us and help us learn and so much. Come on Father's Day and Mother's Day, we'll do a whole thing on that. Somebody else over here? Yes.
I'd like to say, asking for prayers for Emily Temple, our sister.
Okay. Okay. Did you have something?
Yeah, I went to a sick venue for the blessings God gave me this past week and asked for some of the blessings to God in the body so she feels a little better.
Thankful Connie's working.
And also, yeah, Connie got a good job.
Anything else? John.
Maybe obvious and maybe it's hard to mention, but just a great thanksgiving and praise to God for his great love for us that took Jesus to the cross and raised him up from the dead. And the great love that shows us.
And John, it seems like the more one studies that and looks at that, the more you realize how great his love is. And it gets a place where, if you really think about it, knock your socks off just thinking about it. Yeah. Okay, let's go before the Lord. Lord God, we come together today. First, seeking your forgiveness for our wrongdoings, for the times we've turned away from you. We turn back to you this morning. To seek your grace, to seek your forgiveness. Recognizing it is indeed the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, which washes us clean. So we can stand in your presence. So we humbly yet with confidence come into your presence today. Seeking first your Holy Spirit to come into our hearts. To open us up that we can better and better see who you are, see your grace, see your love, see your strength, so we can more and more sense the experience, the peace that you give us in the midst of turmoil, where your word says that you are a refuge, you are a solid rock, you do not change, you're always there for us. So we seek to experience that more and more. And we open our hearts to your Holy Spirit so we can do so. That you would empower us to walk with you each day. That we can move forward according to your plan for our lives, such that our faith journeys, no matter the different ins and outs it may be for us as individuals, will all end up at the gates of heaven. Lord God, we acknowledge you as our Creator, our Provider and Sustainer, our Teacher, our Guide, our Healer, our Redeemer. So we come this morning also knowing that you want us to talk with you, to share with you our concerns as well as acknowledge times when we see you at work in our lives. Knowing that you are the healer, Lord God, we pray for, first of all, spiritual healing for everyone that we've mentioned this morning. That the different difficulties that we're going to ask you to intervene will also include spiritual healing, a growing closer to you, a revelation of your love and your grace. So we ask for your hand to be upon Mary Pomerleau and her mother-in-law, that they can manage the situation in accordance with what you would have them do. We pray for Doug's and Jim's friends, families. It's difficult, Lord, even to go through one funeral a year, much less three in a week. So we ask that your grace and your peace be upon him, Doug and Jim, and Bill and Jenny, as they deal with these losses. Pray, Lord God, that you will continue to assure Nick of your presence and your love and your grace. We pray you will continue to be at work in Nick's heart. When we look at all Nick has come through, Lord God, we know that you're active in his life. We thank you for his open heart to you and ask you would just fill him and lead him in the direction that's going to work out best for him. We pray too for Adam and for the choices he's made that have created great difficulties in many situations. Pray, Lord God, that you will so touch him that it will turn his life around, that he will make choices in accordance with your plan and your salvation. We pray too, Lord, your precious blood, your attention, your grace will be upon Gemma. We pray that you will provide in her life the people and the opportunities that will help keep her safe. If she's gone through difficulties, things will help her heal. That she can have the strength to, as she grows up, to follow you and not to be seriously hurt by the difficulties she goes through. We pray for the cancer that Bob has, that you will shower him with your healing grace, that you will guide the medical personnel in the right treatments for him. We pray also for Connie's health and that you will act on her behalf as well. We pray too, Lord, for your healing power and your grace and your undying love to be upon Emily and her sons. We pray, too, you will continue to strengthen Steve in his ministering to them. We're happy to see the healing that John is going through, and Lord God, ask that you would continue that. Not just so we can see him here more often, but so his life can move forward for you. Thank you, Lord, for work in these difficult times, the opportunities for work. And just pray that we can, as we do in all things, work as to your glory. Thank you, too, for the healing that Shane is seeing in his parents. In strengthening them, it strengthens him. We thank you, Lord, for our families. First, our earthly families to which we're born into, particularly when they help us and nurture us. If some of us have families that haven't, Lord God, we pray you would touch those families to change them around and how they do things. And help us heal from the hurts we may have had growing up. We thank you, Lord, for miracles past, present, and future. We thank you for everybody here, for the families they represent. We ask that your Holy Spirit would minister to them, not just today, but every day. We thank you to have so many that we can share Resurrection Sunday with, the most glorious day of the church year. And Lord God, we thank you for travel mercies you give all of us. And pray your continued travel mercies to be upon us. And Lord, there may be things that others have thought of, but they have not held up to you. We hold them up to you, nonetheless. You know what they are. And as always, ask your grace to be upon them. These many things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Where two or three are gathered in my name, there am I in their midst. And whatsoever ye shall ask, I will do. Alleluia, alleluia.
Amen. Whew. You guys bring much more. I'll spend a whole hour praying. I mean, that's it's good to pray. If my assistant will come up, we shall move on to the message of the resurrection eggs. Okay, what so you know what we're going to do. Evie is going to introduce each egg and talk about it, and I will add a little bit to what she shares as we move through each egg, hopefully to help you, if you don't already know the Easter story, to know it, and if you already know it, to hopefully know it a little better. Okay. How about if I do this?
If you want, song
back. Speak into this so it can be recorded. Okay?
Okay.
Speak, make sure he can hear you.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes. Hold on. When you speak, put it back on and then back.
No, I'll just go back.
Egg one, blue, riding on a donkey. Matthew 21:1-9. Who has the dark blue egg with the donkey in it?
Yeah, go, Sissy.
Can I have it?
Thank you.
Good job, sis.
Where'd it go? There it is. A lowly donkey was given to Jesus to ride into Jerusalem just before his death and resurrection. Isn't it exciting that a donkey owner freely gave his donkey when he found out it was for Jesus? What many people don't know is that it was common for a king to ride on a donkey in times of peace. And although Jesus was the King of Kings, God the Father wanted him to bring peace to the people when he came to earth. The Bible often refers to Jesus as the Prince of Peace. Jesus gives us peace that is not like the peace the world gives. Jesus' peace comes as we repent or trust from our sins, or turn from our sins, and embrace him as the Son of God. And as we continue to obey and trust him as the Lord of our lives, we will experience even more of his peace.
Many people believe that Jesus was the Son of God. Many were healed of sickness or blindness. So when Jesus rode into Jerusalem, people were eager to see him. How excited they were to see the Messiah, the Savior, the chosen one of God. They wanted to be near him, talk to him, and hear him speak. They were shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." For those of you who may or may not know, Hosanna means "God save us." So they were actually calling out to Jesus to save them. And also, that Sunday was a Sunday in the Jewish tradition where people would bring their Passover sacrifice, their lambs, their doves, whatever it might be, to the temple for approval. So on this day, when he was riding a donkey, he was actually hailed as the saving lamb. And they were approving him as their lamb for sacrifice. They may not have known that, yet that's what was going on at that time. And it was easy for the people to follow him, though, when things were going well. But when Jesus challenged the Jewish leaders by saying he was the Son of God, people were afraid that if they admitted they were followers and believed he was God, that they might be in danger too. However, the truth is that God calls us to follow Jesus no matter what. It may be hard times. Others may try to tempt us not to follow him. But we need to listen to God and trust what he says. There will be those who don't love Jesus. Actually, there are going to be people in your lives who do not know Jesus. So they are not going to necessarily be friendly to what you are about. But that should not keep us from obeying him or following him. For he does not change. He will bless us and protect us if we love him and follow him and his word in the Bible.
Egg tip, bite pink, silver coins, Matthew 26:14-16, 46-50, 27:1-5. Who has the pink egg with the three coins in it? Judas accepted 30 silver coins for betraying Jesus into the hands of the Jewish leaders. The Jewish leaders wanted to get rid of Jesus. He was not the kind of Messiah or Son of God they wanted. They were looking for God to send a warrior king who was riding on a horse, not a donkey, one who would conquer the Roman Empire that ruled over the Jews. But that was not God's plan.
Instead of a conquering warrior king, Jesus came as a man, peaceful, humble, and full of God's love. He came to earth to show us this love, to teach us that true life and goodness only comes from our Father in heaven. We experience the best of God's goodness for us when God comes into our lives, changes our hearts, and gives us the ability to follow Jesus. We really can't do anything good without God. And I just want to say here, folks, a lot of people say, "What's God done for me?" My question is, have you made the decision to walk with him? I can have $1 million over here for you, but if you walk away from me, how can I give it to you? I can't. And that's where we talk about turning back to God, open up your heart to him, and find out how much he really has for you. And so the people here, the question was, how much were they willing to take him into their heart? For when the Pharisees were not very good, parading around showing how good they thought they were, their hearts were evil and sinful. They were judgmental, selfish, and prideful. Jesus wanted people to know that was wrong. He said it's not what's on the outside that's important, it's what's in our hearts that really matter.
Egg 3, light purple, the Passover cup. Matthew 26:17-19, 26-28. Who has the light purple egg with the cup in it?
Well,
Here comes Sissy again. At Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples before he died on the cross, he used a cup of wine to explain his death. Christians still drink from the cup to remember Christ's blood poured out from our sins. Did you know hundreds of years before Jesus came to Egypt, Egypt made God's people into slaves? It's true. God sent Moses to tell the Pharaoh to free the Jews. But the Pharaoh disobeyed God and refused to let them go. Part of God's punishment for the Pharaohs and his people was to send a destroyer to kill the firstborn in Egypt. But God told his people, the Jews, to put blood of lamb on their doors as a sign of their faith. He told the destroyer to pass over their houses that had the lamb's blood on their doors and not to kill their children. Since then, as a way of remembering God's great love and protection, Jews celebrate Passover every year.
So you folks know part of why we're doing this is the only way we record things. This is the only thing that records. And we like to record our services for people who can't either be here or log on to go to our website and can still take part. Oops. Have you ever heard that we too are slaves and need to be free just like the Jews in Egypt? That too is true. We need to let go from our slavery to sin. So God sent Jesus as a perfect lamb, the Lamb of God, to save us. Because God and his Son are perfect, the perfect blood from Jesus' death on the cross forever protects his followers from being destroyed. Any one of us who truly love and trust in Jesus will be saved from our sins and eternal death. We will be passed over from death in the same way that the angel of death passed over the Jewish people in Egypt. Personally, I think that is great news.
Egg 4, orange, praying hands, Mark 14, 32 through 34. Who has the orange egg with the praying hands in it? Can I have it? Thank you. You think this is it? Praying hands remind us that Jesus went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray with his disciples. Jesus gives us a wonderful example of the importance of prayer. He often went off by himself to pray with his to pray to God the Father. During his difficult times in his life before he was captured, Jesus asked his disciples to come with him. He wanted them to pray and keep him company.
Jesus was troubled at that time. He knew he was going to die. Since he never sins, he never experienced the results of his own sin. By dying on the cross, Jesus knew he would have to experience God forsaking him because God has to reject sin. And at that point, Jesus carried all of our sin. And although he knew that would happen, I think that his last words of Christ actually tell you he was not prepared for how painful that was for him. Remember when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Even though he knew that was to happen, still it was pain that he could not that he was not prepared to bear, although he did. He was willing to die on the cross because he knew it was his Father's plan to save people who put their trust in him. In fact, he even went through that pain so we could be forgiven. Do you think it would be hard to die and have God turn away from you? Have you ever felt God's turned away from you in this life? Would you pray? Jesus was God, but even he believed prayer to his Father was needed. So Jesus went to the garden at Gethsemane with his disciples to pray. Do you ever get tired when you try to pray? Jesus' disciples were weak when they tried to be strong on their own apart from God. So this is a reminder, all of us, we cannot be strong on our own. We need to be in prayer and ask for God's strength, just as Jesus did.
Lenin Whip, John 19, 1 through 5, Matthew 27, 26 through 31. Who has the green egg with the whip in it?
This is one of our oldest kids.
Yeah, if you subtract like 100 years. After his trial by Pilate, the Roman soldiers used leather ropes with rocks and metal woven into whip Jesus, leaving 39 deep gashes in his skin. At more than any time, these dark and evil days were scary and sad for the followers of Jesus. The Jewish leaders had brought Jesus before the Roman Empire governor in Judea, Pontius Pilate, to defend himself for claiming to be God. Because Jesus claimed to be God, they said he was the enemy, the Roman Empire, and of Caesar, its king. They wanted him sentenced to death.
Can you believe Pilate put Jesus to death? But before he did, he told his soldiers to scourge or whip him. At any time, Jesus, the Son of God, could have stopped the trial, stopped the whipping, even stopped his death. But he wanted to do the will of the Father, and he did nothing and said nothing to defend himself. In the Bible, a long time ago, it was foretold that Jesus would be whipped and beaten. Isaiah 56 says, I gave my back to those who strike me, my cheek to those who pluck out the beard. I did not cover my face from humiliation and spitting. Isaiah also says, but he was pierced through for our transgressions, our breaking of God's law. He was crushed for our sins. The punishment for our well-being fell upon him, and by his scourging we are healed. In other words, he took the whip for us, and we are healed. God allows his Son to be whipped in our place for our sins. Jesus didn't deserve to die, but we have sinned, and Jesus died in our place for sin, even though it was we who deserved to be punished. I just want to say here that they quote Isaiah. Isaiah has a lot of prophecy in about just what the suffering servant, the Messiah, is going to be like. And it is almost word for word exactly what happened. Now, the people who would want to deny that, up until the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, the oldest manuscript we had was 200 years A.D. And a lot of people would want to deny that the death and resurrection happened. We'll say, well, all that prophecy in Isaiah, the Christian people wrote that in after his death. What's interesting is when they found the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were 200 years before Jesus' death, the best preserved parts of all that manuscript were the parts that dealt with the prophecy about the Messiah. So these are true words. God's proven what he said.
Egg 6, light yellow, crown of thorns, Matthew 27, 29-31. Who has the light yellow egg with the crown of thorns? He's coming up. The soldiers who crucified Jesus placed a crown of thorns on his head so they could mock him, saying, Hail the King of Jews. Can you believe that some of the same people who were praising Jesus as God for a few days before, when he rode into Jerusalem on a donkey, were now treating him like a wicked person? They decided if Jesus was was God, he would save himself from having to die. But Jesus made it clear to the people that that was not the Father's plan. That the Father's plan was not what they expected or wanted. God's amazing plan was to save sinners by allowing his Son, Jesus, to die on the cross to pay the death penalty for them. Yet people choose not to believe Jesus and reject him.
We should never believe others when they tell us Jesus is not God. Yet at the same time, we should never be mean or treat somebody badly just because others do. We should always be doing what God's word tells us to do. And the Bible tells us we should love one another because it's the right way to show that we love God. The Roman guards did not love God. They rejected Jesus as God. They teased him, taunted him, and beat him. They made a crown out of sharp thorns put on Jesus' head, kneeled before him, and teased him by saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," even though they didn't believe he was a king. Then they spit on him and took a strong hollow stick called a reed and beat Jesus on the head. They crushed the crown of thorns into his head and caused him to bleed badly. Some folks say those thorns were at least an inch long. And still Jesus showed them the love of God by forgiving and praying for them. Actually, in Jesus' day, thorns was a symbol for sin and trouble and tribulation. So he took your sin and my sin literally on his head and bled from them, from the points of what we did. And yet he did not stop loving them in spite of what they did.
Egg 7, yellow. The nails on the cross. John 19:16 through 22. Who had the yellow egg with the cross?
That's okay. We didn't have that one recorded.
Three large nails were driven into Jesus' wrists and his feet to nail him to the cross. The reason that they were driven into here instead of into here is because it would be more painful. One, two, it would hold him on the cross better. Three, there's a vein there for blood, and so many other reasons, but I just can't think of them all right now. Why did Jesus have to die? He died so our sins could be forgiven, and so we could forget forever, and so we could live forever with God. In Romans 3:23, the Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God.
In the beginning, actually, when God created Adam and Eve, he gave mankind the opportunity of freedom of choice. People say, why are there such bad things that go on in the world? Because God gives freedom of choice, which means some people are going to make choices that may not be pleasant for you. At the same time, you have a choice of how you are going to respond to that, also of things that you will do. And I dare say all of us at times have chosen the wrong thing to do because it has felt right, or it has seemed right, or the world has said, this is what you do. And yet it's been the wrong thing because very rarely does that result in a good outcome. And yet human beings want to deny God, to disobey him, to rebel against him, because we want to do what we want to do. And even kids, you know, although they may not fully understand right from wrong, they do things nonetheless that lead in that direction, whether they don't share toys or they want to hit on a brother or sister. Young people, it's okay if you're angry at your brother or sister. It's not okay to hit them, okay? With your words or your fists. Also, times when we lie or cheat or steal. Anybody hedge on their income tax ever? We don't do what we're supposed to do. God wants us to honor and respect one another. But when we sin, we're saying to God that we want to be the God or ruler of our own lives. No matter how hard we try, we can't reach God. There's a chasm between man and God, and that's caused by the wrong things we do. You can't be with God when you're doing wrong things. The good news is that God provided the way for us to escape the punishment of sin by sending us Jesus. You could almost visualize the cross being the bridge, the gap that covers the gap. So if we, by his death on the cross, Jesus built this bridge so believers can cross this canyon of sin and separation. So when we as Christians think of the nails that were pounded through Jesus' body into the cross, we should be sad about our sins. Yet as we look at today being Resurrection Sunday, we should also be filled with joy because we know we are given everlasting life through Christ's death. Indeed, he was pierced for us so we could have life with him.
Egg 8, light green, dice for gambling. John 19, 32 through 30, 25, 20, 23 through 25. Who has the kind of like a light green egg with the dice? Thank you. The Roman soldiers used dice to gamble for Jesus' robe. Did you know that Jesus hardly owned anything in this world? So when the soldiers gambled for Jesus' clothes at the cross, it was sad that they were so selfish and cared so little for him. Psalm 22:18 foretells hundreds of years before this event how Roman soldiers would gamble for Jesus' clothes. They divided my garments along them, and for my clothes they cast lots or made bets.
Jesus shows us what we are to do when others wrong us. He actually asked for forgiveness from his Father for the soldiers who were about to crucify him. Luke 23:34 tells us he prayed, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." Isn't this a great example of how we should treat those who are mean to us or hate us? Actually, the world says hate them back. The world says be mean to them back. And you know what? Now they're angry at you again, and they're going to be mean to you. Well, the world says be mean back to them, and then you're back to them, and then back to them, and back to them. Somebody has to do something different to end that circle. I call it a whirlpool. We know from God's word we are to pray for our enemies. We're told we need to forgive them just as Jesus showed us. Let me say one thing about forgiveness. It doesn't say, therefore I trust you, therefore I want to be your friend, therefore I'm going to get back together with you, as if none of this happened. Forgiveness says I'm going to let it go. I'm not going to hold it against you. I'm not going to carry a grudge. Even if I don't want to be in a relationship with you, I wish you the best. I'm not going to carry it around. And indeed, when Jesus forgave us, what he meant is, God, don't hold it against them, for they didn't know what they're doing.
Egg 9, purple, the soldier's fear. John 10:31 through 37. Who has the purple egg with the spear? Can I have it? Thank you. Roman soldiers used a spear to stab into Jesus' side. That's what I'm going to say. When he was on the cross. Here's an amazing fact about Jesus' death. When people were put to death on the cross, it was common for Roman soldiers to break their legs. With broken legs, a person could not hold himself up to keep from suffocating. He would die quicker.
Two robbers were crucified with Jesus, one on each side. The soldiers broke the legs of the first and then of the second. The reason they did that was that according to their ritual of the Passover, you couldn't have anybody hanging on a cross over the Sabbath day. So rather than just waiting for 2 or 3 days for you to suffocate and die, because some people took that long, if they broke your leg, what you had to do on the cross, you had to push yourself up to be able to breathe. The nails with the pain, every time you would push yourself up, pain would explode throughout your whole body because of that nerve that it was up against. Also, Jesus' back was raked by that whip. Crosses were not smooth pieces of wood. They were rough. So not only did you feel it in the pain from your arms, you're scraping your back up against that just to breathe. So you died on the cross from suffocation, ultimate suffocation. And so that's why they broke the robber's legs. So they would die before sundown so they could get him off the cross. Well, Jesus was already dead. And actually, if any of you are interested, there's a good book. It's called The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel. And it talks, he goes into all kind of things, the facts. It is a very factual book about the resurrection. And one of the things that this proves, this spearing aside, is that if a person died on the cross from that suffocation, what they would have in their chest cavity was a lot of fluid and some blood. And the scriptures say when they stuck him with the spear, fluid and blood, water and blood came out. So if anybody wants to tell you Jesus didn't die on the cross, you got the proof right there. And actually, God foretold hundreds of years before Psalm 34:20 that this would happen. That he would not, his legs would not be broken. It says he keeps all his bones; not one of them is broken. Jesus gave up his life and died before the soldiers could even get to him.
I'd like to say one more thing about this sphere thing. It's something I actually learned at the ice cream shop yesterday. Thank you, Benny, for letting me work. This girl named Megan, at her school, she learned something about how the only way that fluid and blood could both come out is from a literal broken heart. So I'm not sure if he really got a literal broken heart or if one of the whipping hit it or something might have happened with that because of the fluid coming out too.
Make it quick.
And didn't one of the robbers ask Jesus to forgive him?
Yes. He asked him to. One of the robbers did. One of the robbers mocked him. And the other robber says, "Why are you mocking him?" And he turned and says, "Ask forgiveness," and Jesus gave him forgiveness, said, "Today you will be with me in paradise." Yes, he did. So even his forgiveness was even still working on the cross in such pain. Still working. Good point.
I really was at 10. Thank you, people. It might take a while now. Egg 10, cream, linen wrapping, Matthew 27:57-61. Who has this egg with the creamy egg, kind of, with the kind of blanket? Thank you. Joseph of Arimathea wrapped the body of Jesus in a linen cloth after he died on the cross. Some Jewish leaders secretly believed that Jesus was the Messiah, their Savior, but didn't want anyone to know their belief. The Bible tells that Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus, both members of the leadership, the Jewish leadership called Sanhedrin, believed Jesus was the Son of God and trusted him for their salvation. But they were afraid that if anyone knew their belief, they might be killed too.
However, it seems that after Jesus died on the cross, they couldn't hide their faith any longer. Isn't it exciting to know that Joseph of Arimathea loved Jesus so much he was willing to put his own life in danger? And actually, you know, he was already dressed in his clothing for the Passover. He was already spiritually pure for the Passover. And if you touch blood, you were ritually unpure. That's where it says, he couldn't hide it any longer. And even though he was going to be ritually impure, he took him down from the cross. Also, Nicodemus, a lot of people say he was the other person with him. And Nicodemus was the one that says, asked Jesus, how can a man be born again? And Jesus talked about being born again to Nicodemus. And so after they had buried him, Joseph of Arimathea and probably Nicodemus also had to walk home. And they had to get home in quickly because people saw them. They were going to go, oh, you need to be killed. What's interesting is that not only did they risk that, the blood that was going to make them ritually impure as far as the old ways went, that's the blood that redeemed him. That's the blood that redeems you and me. That's why you think, what faith did this man show? Wow.
Egg 11, pink. The stone of the tomb, Matthew 28:1-3. A large stone that had covered the tomb was found rolled away. A large stone, bigger than a door and as heavy as a rock, was placed over the opening of the tomb to prevent grave robbers from stealing the body of a dead person or valuables in the tomb that had belonged to the dead person.
In the case of Jesus, the Pharisees were worried Jesus' disciples or other followers would take the body and then say Jesus had risen from the dead. In order to prevent this, Pilate had soldiers guard the tomb. Pilate even had the soldiers close the tomb with an official Roman seal on the edge of the stone. They were sure this would keep the disciples from stealing Jesus' body because the penalty for breaking this seal was death. The Roman soldiers also knew the penalty for them was death if anyone broke the seal during their watch over the tomb. So what a surprise it was then when they, on Resurrection Sunday morning, where the two Marys and the other lady that went with her found the stone rolled away. The soldiers were gone. The women found the tomb empty except for Jesus' grave clothes. They didn't know what to do. They remembered, though, that Jesus had told them he would rise from the dead. If only they'd remember Jesus' words. At that point, you see, they were in such shock and confusion and fear, they weren't remembering Jesus' words. If only they'd remember them, then they would have had faith instead of fear and confusion. Are there things in your life that cause you to be afraid and confused? If so, maybe just like they needed to experience a risen Jesus in order to clear that up, maybe we need the same. I know there are times I do. In fact, that's all the time.
Egg 12, light blue. The egg is empty. The tomb is empty. Represents the tomb is empty. Matthew 28:5-8. Who has the light blue egg? Jesus' tomb was empty because he rose from the dead. This was a very special time at the tomb. Mary Magdalene and another Mary saw an angel who too told them not to be afraid. He said that no one had taken the body of Jesus. No one had taken Jesus' body, but instead he had risen from the dead. The angel told them to go tell the disciples what they had seen, that Jesus has risen. Can you believe how excited they were? They ran wee, wee, wee all the way home. Just kidding. They ran all the way home to tell the disciples the good news. He is risen. Alleluia.
And actually, after this, Jesus appeared in person to Peter, to the 12 disciples, and then to more than 500 people. Because Jesus appeared on different occasions to so many people, people saw him with their own eyes and even touched him. We have proof that Jesus rose from the dead. As he rose from the dead, Jesus did what no one had ever done before. Both God and man, he overcame sin, death, and hell. So sin, death, and hell no longer have any real power over those who believe in Jesus and have his spirit leading them. This doesn't mean that sin, death, and hell don't come beating at your door at times. It says it does not have power over you. Instead of being slaves to sin and death, Christians, by the power of his spirit, are free to obey God and do good. The Bible says in John 8:36, "So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed." Like the tomb, our hearts are empty and lifeless without Jesus. But as we repent and turn from sin, believe and trust in Jesus' death and resurrection, he fills our heart with the life and the Holy Spirit. As we read the Bible, the Holy Spirit helps us obey God by reminding us of what his word says. God's Spirit never goes against God's word. In fact, when we read the Bible, the Holy Spirit can speak into our lives in powerful ways. Isn't that awesome? Just one more thing about God that you find is awesome.
I just want to say one more thing before we end. Make sure you stay for the egg hunt.
Cut. Anybody want to give a hand to my assistant? Okay, since we are past our usual time, although it's a special Sunday, I guess we can take a little more time to look at what had happened that day. Actually, the whole week, if you think about it, we started with Palm Sunday, we end up with Resurrection Sunday. And certainly something to think about, the journey that Jesus went on in that week and the journey that he can take us on if we just desire to open our hearts to him and to walk with him each day. So rather than do a discussion at this point, if there's anything, anybody, what?
I'd like to just say, I'm not saying I don't do this, but I think everyone has said, why does this day so hard on me, or why is everything going wrong? But if you think about it, Jesus
actually, it's we have things happen to us. The question is, do we get so thrown by it that we forget about who we are as Christians? Because Jesus, even for his disciples, and this was during the Last Supper in the book of John, when he was given a whole discourse of different teachings, and Jesus prayed for his disciples. He didn't say, "I pray they will never have any problems in this life, that they will just run along smoothly and life will be just a bowl of cherries until they come home to heaven." What he asked was that God would strengthen them and hold them true to their faith. And the reason we have those difficulties is because we have to live in this world. We just don't have to be of it. We don't have to take part in the world's ways and the world's values. Yes, you have to eat, and yes, you have to have a warm, dry place to sleep at night, and yes, it helps to be safe with your family. God knows all that. God knows all that. And if you decide you're going to follow him, he will do things in a way so that your needs will be met as you continue to follow him. And yes, we will have hard times, and it's excellent that you would say, if we think about the hard times Jesus went through, and yet he stayed true to what his task was, then our life maybe is for the most part a bowl of cherries compared to that. I can't imagine the pain that he went through. I've tried that. I mean, I've gotten tears in my eyes and everything else, but I can't imagine. And
if I'd asked for that pain or done something, maybe that's one thing, but he didn't. He didn't deserve a bit of it. How many of us would say, I don't deserve this. I shouldn't have this. Folks, when you start saying what you should and shouldn't have in life, you're starting out with unrealistic expectations. I shouldn't have this. I shouldn't have this. Well, Jesus shouldn't have had that, but he took it all. And sometimes it's when we're in difficult times and we stay true. I'll end on this. And stay true to what we need to be doing as children of God. Then that's when we see God at work. That's when we see God at work. If everything is fine all the time, we don't see God at work. We say, ain't life grand? We don't say, most people don't say, isn't God grand? So it's when things are tough that we experience God helping see us through. So good point. Rachel.
Last Sunday, we had a beautiful Sunday. There weren't as many people, but it was the first Sunday that I had seen charity signing. And it made me reflect upon some things that, you know, a lot of times you go to church and you're just a member of a large member of, you know, a large mass of people. And you don't pay attention to the other people. You do what you do at church, then you go home, and there's really not as much involvement. You're blessed if you do get to be more involved in church and in what they may do in the community. But we're a small church. We know what each and every single one of us do. We can't get away with a lot of things like that, and I often, just as we were just talking, you know, the things can be really tough, and we think that they're really tough. I came last week to church and was reminded of watching Charity, was reminded of all that she does. I mean, she's not just a mom of two really great kids, but she works. She doesn't just work one job. She does, you know, other part-time things on the side. And she is involved in the community because of her children and because of her family with, you know, learning how to sign and putting herself out there for businesses and so many other things. And just for God to bring her to our church to give us the opportunity to realize how much more we can do when we open up our eyes and start walking with him, I just want to say thank you to God and thank you to Charity.
Very good. It's true. The more we open our eyes to the opportunities, the more when we're drawn to an opportunity, the more God gives us the wherewithal, energy, strength, focus, help to be able to do that. Very good. Okay, let's close in by singing our closing hymn together, number 358. Is that the start of it? Joy he gives. Greater still. Calm assurance. We can face uncertain days.
I don't care what the headlines on CNN say tomorrow. We can face
uncertain days. Because he lives. Because he lives. I can face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. One day I'll cross the river, fight life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know he reigns. I'll face tomorrow because he lives. All fear is gone because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he Now may indeed he who has sent his son for you and me, he who gave all he had so that we could have him, may he continue to dwell in your heart, to bring you peace and joy in the midst of turmoil, to give you strength, to continue to bless you with all the things for which we praise him. Amen.